welcome to worship. I've got a few things to share with you today. I think we are starting with the food pantry, right? So this Saturday is our food pantry distribution. I'm going to ask if you can be flexible. We might need some extra help getting some things ready this week. So if you get an email asking for some volunteer time, please keep an eye out for that. We're trying to get all that buttoned up. Please, please pray. We've got a couple big things going on. Our food pantry here at the church is distributing on Saturday, November 18th. The Sunday Breakfast Mission is doing their distribution on Monday and Tuesday, the 20th and 21st. Particularly for the Sunday Breakfast Mission, they have well over 1,000 families expected, right?
1,300,
yeah. So that is a lot of families that need a lot of prayer. One of the things we are really praying for is that everyone who would come through these pantries would be receptive to the gospel. That as we're sharing food, we're also sharing love. We want our brothers and sisters, our neighbors, to know that we love them, that we want to make sure their bodies are cared for, but we also want to share the gospel message. Please.
We should also mention a sister Nazarene church is also involved in this. Laurel Nazarene has 200 signed up.
Amen. Amen.
That's in Laurel, Delaware.
In Laurel, Delaware. Amen. Wonderful, wonderful. So I think most people don't understand that the Sunday Breakfast Mission is operating in, what, three or four states now?
Four states.
Yeah, Maryland, Delaware, New Jersey, and Pennsylvania, right? Yeah. So, yeah. It's pretty amazing. You should talk to Pastor John sometime about all the different things the mission does. It'll be an eye-opening conversation. But like I said, we're working on food, but we want to share love. We want to share the gospel message. Going along with that, the Sunday Breakfast Mission training for the evangelism training dinner is this Thursday, November 16th at 5:30 p.m. at the mission. You don't have to be volunteering at the missions distribution in order to attend. Pastor Tom and the mission have opened up the invitation for this to anyone from our church who would like to go. So if you are involved in any way, really, in any kind of ministry, this is a great training. It's a way to learn about how to share your faith and share the gospel message. It can be a little bit intimidating if you've never had a conversation like that with somebody you've never met. This is a great way to break that ice, to learn some skills, to have a plan, and to practice a little bit. So Thursday, November 16th at 5:30 p.m. I know we have at least one person going over to volunteer in the food box distribution. That is Monday and Tuesday, November 20th and 21st, and it's all day, 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. One of the things I'm asking is that on Saturday from 8:30 to 11:30, and then Monday and Tuesday from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m., if you would take some time to pray during those times. I know not all of us are able to be in person, either here or at the mission, or in Laurel's, the other church that Pastor Tom mentioned. But please take time in those moments to pray for all of the volunteers who are sharing. It really does matter, and it really does make a difference. A couple things going on as we're going through the holiday season. Our community Thanksgiving Eve service this year is being hosted by St. Ambrose. We're very thankful to Pastor Mason and the church there. We had the privilege of hosting last year, so this year we're traveling. It's an away game. So we are gonna be at St. Ambrose Church. It's Wednesday, November 22nd at 7 p.m. And I hope everybody can make it out. We really wanna have a good showing. They had a lot of people that came over to visit us at our church last year, and we want to send lots of our people over there to visit their church this year. If you have any questions about that service, please let me know. No, I don't know if Pastor Mason is singing, but I'm going to try my best to encourage him to do so. All right. We also have some holiday dates and times that are set. These are all going to be in your bulletin next week, but we wanted to just throw them in the rolling announcements so you have them all. We are going to be doing Christmas decorating on Saturday, November 25th at, was it 9 a.m. we said?
9 to 12.
Saturday, November 25th, that was on the slide, from 9 to 12, we're going to be meeting here at the church. Now, here's why this is important. First of all, we have a big church and lots of decorations to put up. Second of all, if you're here to help, you get to decide which decorations get put up and where they get put. That also means that if you don't come, you just have to accept whatever we put up. So if it's just me, I'm putting some stuff in weird places. So y'all need to come out here and keep me in check, or we're gonna have Christmas trees upside down in the bathroom, okay? Yeah. We could, you know, we got some hooks in the ceiling over here. I've been wondering if we could hang a Christmas tree from there. I don't know. But yeah, so Saturday, November 25th from 9 to 12, we always serve refreshments there, some kind of lunch. We haven't nailed down the menu yet, but we usually either do like a hoagie tray or pizza or something like that. So don't worry, we'll feed you. Yes?
Maybe people that come for that can bring a box of stuffing or a cup of
sure.
I'll be down there doing that.
Yeah, that would be wonderful.
Christmas is tight too.
It is. Couple other things as far as the Christmas season goes. We are going to be doing our Christmas caroling on Saturday, December 23rd. So that is the Saturday before Christmas. If you would like to have, if you have a place you want us to stop, I guess we're going to put Diane in charge. You're in charge. Thanks for nodding yes. Please talk to Diane or you can talk to me. We are definitely going over to Village Arms and we are going to go through the hallways and sing to all the residents there. A lot of people there don't get to see family over the holidays, and it's really important that we bring a little bit of love over there, not just turkeys.
Can we play it by 15 minutes? That's my Saturday work, and I'm going to go. I don't get back at Penn's until
1
o'clock.
Sure. We'll figure it out.
Okay,
yep. Even if you have to meet us there, we'll make it work.
Okay.
Yep. And we do need some strong singers. If you were there last year, you had the unfortunate experience of hearing me lead a couple songs. So, you want to do it? Okay. Miss Anna's going to be a song leader. So if you have a home you want to make sure we go to, we're, like I said, we're visiting Village Arms, and then we try to prioritize some of our brothers and sisters who aren't able to get out to worship, some of our shut-ins, and we'll do as many as we can. And we usually run out of gas after about 3 or 4 hours, but sometimes at Village Arms, listen, I'm just going to say, last year, Mary Pierce made homemade Christmas cookies. And they even travel. I have it on good authority that you can put a few in your coat pocket and keep them with you, and they'll keep you going for the rest of the singing, right, brother? Yeah. So, on a related note, if we carpool, sit next to Daryl, he'll probably have cookies in his pocket. That was my favorite thing to happen this year. Okay. And then our Christmas Eve service. This year, Christmas Eve is on a Sunday. So we are going to have our Christmas Eve candlelight service that we always have. I know we adjust the time sometimes because Santa and the fire truck disrupt the service a little bit. We're going to stick with our normal Sunday evening time of 6 p.m. So that will take the place of our regular Sunday evening service. But Christmas Eve, Sunday, December 24th, we will be having our candlelight service here in the sanctuary at 6 p.m. We end that service by standing in a circle around the sanctuary, and we light candles, everybody gets to hold one, and we sing Silent Night together with the light of the Lord shining through our candles. And I know for me that's always a special thing. If you haven't been able to be at one of those services, it really is kind of cool. The Monday and Tuesday after Christmas, we are not going to be having, or Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday after Christmas, we're not going to be having our regular weekly events because of the holiday. We'll go back to our regular service the week after. And we had some debate. I'm calling it. I think we have men's group on New Year's Day. What do you think? Start the new year off right? Okay, good. Let's see. Advent devotionals are our other Christmas thing. We've only got two more Sundays before Advent starts, this week and next week, and then it's Advent. So if you have not grabbed an Advent devotional book, they are on the table out in the foyer. It's a really good book this year. It was written by Dr. Dan Boone, who is the president of Tribeca Nazarene University. I know we've got some people from our crew that have attended there. It's a really good book. If you have, if you are able to make a donation to cover the cost of the book, they cost us about $7, but we want to make sure everybody has one. So if you don't have the money, please take one. If you've got the money to cover somebody else's, please throw that in. Couple other extra announcements that we don't have up on there. We are still working to get the Linwood House buttoned up. We are still working on raising money for the windows. We don't have our full amount there yet. We are at $2,570. But if you take a peek over there, Daryl has been furiously painting outside before the weather got cold. He's got both porches and the mailbox painted, and it looks really, really special. We are also looking, if you're interested in making a donation other than money towards the windows, there are lots of other household items that we're starting to collect, like curtain rods and curtains and some things like that. We're not gonna fully furnish the house, but we wanna try to get some of that stuff in there to make it look presentable. So if you would like to help out with any of that, please talk to Daryl. He's in charge. And a special thank you to Daryl and Charlene for heading up that project and all the work that Daryl's been doing. I especially appreciate the grip tape on the steps so that I don't fall on my behind when it snows. So very nice. We are also furiously editing the church directory that we've been working on. If you did not get your picture taken when we did directory pictures, if you can email a picture to the church email address, it's pvcotn@comcast.net, Pennsville Church of the Nazarene, pvcotn@comcast.net. We can take a picture that you have and we can edit it to put it in either a family photo or an individual photo. If you don't send one to us, we'll be contacting you if you don't have a picture in there. You can choose to not have your picture in the bulletin or in the directory if you would like that. But we do reserve the right to put a picture of one of our puppets in place if you do not submit a picture. I'm just saying. And you might be getting a phone call to check information.
What's the cutoff date to send a picture in for?
Well, we would really like to have the directory out by Christmas. So as soon as possible would be the best. So if you know that we didn't take your picture and you have a photo we can use, please call us. If you need help getting a picture taken, we can do reshoots. But yeah, does that answer your question? Yeah, we're gonna try really hard to have that all ready for Christmas. But if it gets pushed back, we wanna make sure everybody's included. So we're trying to balance expediency with inclusion. We are also updating our Christmas card list. That's gonna be out in a couple of weeks. We plan to have that out for the first week of Advent. We are probably gonna have it out a week ahead of time so everybody can take a peek and let us know what we did wrong. And I wrote volunteers on here. Oh, Sunday Night Kids. As you know, we are taking a break right now from our Sunday Night Kids program because we don't have enough volunteers. We've had a couple people contact us. We really need at least two more, okay? We're really shooting to add four more adults to our rotation. So if that's something that you are interested in, that program runs during our Sunday night service. It starts at 6 p.m. The classes usually run till about 7:15-ish, and then we have dinner together after that. So if you're available for that, please talk to Jill or one of the board members. We do require that everyone who works with children goes through a background check. The church provides that, you don't have to pay for that. But we do require background checks for all of our volunteers. I think a lot of you probably know that. And that background check includes some training videos to watch, including like what it means to be a mandatory reporter and some rules about, you know, what do you do if a kid needs to go to the bathroom and some stuff like that. Make sure we have the highest of standards to protect our kids. If you have questions, you can talk to me, or you can talk to Jill, or one of our board members. Okay, anything else before we get to birthdays? We have a very special birthday this week. It's Wilma Martinez's birthday on the 16th. So we get to sing happy birthday to Wilma today. And I have it on good authority that she might be on our list for our next prayer crawl. So if you are able to attend our next prayer crawl, you get to go visit Tony and Wilma and pray with them in their house. Awesome. All right, we ready to sing to Wilma?
We are ready.
Okay, let's sing.
This is your birthday song. It isn't very long.
Happy birthday, Wilma.
Happy birthday, Wilma. In our opening prayer today, we'd like to take a moment to recognize the holiday that we do have Veterans Day that we are celebrating, and today is the Sunday closest. We are very grateful for those who serve, and we also recognize the cost that that requires. I know it's Veterans Day and not Memorial Day, but it's hard to separate the two. We know that many of you have lost loved ones who have been in the service, and those of you who have served have lost friends. And we just want to take a moment and pray for our veterans now. We had some discussion in Sunday school today about the best way to lead this prayer and what to pray for. And thank you, Rich, for your input there, brother. I appreciate it. As one of our veterans, thank you, brother. But let's take a moment and pray for this service, but also especially for our veterans. Father God, thank you for this day and this chance to gather together. Father, we thank you for the fact that in this city, in this country, that we are able to gather today in freedom and safety. And we recognize, Father, that a lot of people around the world don't have that. And we know that in no small part that is because of our veterans. And so, Father, we thank you for our brothers and sisters who have accepted a call to serve. And we lift them up to you today. Father, one of the things we pray for right now is for peace in our world. We know that no one seeks peace more than a veteran who's experienced the horrors of war. And so, Father, we pray for peace, that war would stop, and that if there's any way that we could be a part of it, that we would help to bring about peace in this world. We pray for those who are deployed right now, Father. We think of John's son Joshua over in Iraq having missiles shot at their base. Many around the world, Father, not just American soldiers, but many who are deployed right now, Father, away from families and facing danger. We think of those, Father, who have returned from the armed services, bearing physical wounds, but also mental and emotional and spiritual wounds because of what they've been through. And Father, we pray for healing and love. We pray that our church and other churches would be loving places for our veterans to find a home and to be loved and cared for and to find healing. Father, we pray for the medical services and other services provided to our veterans in this country, that they would be able to have the help that they need, both with physical treatment and also mental health and emotional health. And Father, we just pray for those who are hurt and wounded. We yearn for the time that you talk about at the end of Revelation, Father, when death and sorrow and war will be gone. And in the meantime, Father, we turn to you for help healing our wounded and comforting those who are experiencing loss. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's begin our worship and singing this morning with Desert Song. Please stand with us if you're able.
Try. your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship Him.
Special day on Veterans Day. Every year my Facebook page blows up with thanks. And on behalf of all the veterans, I'd like to say it was our honor. Today's reading is from Psalms 119, verses 54 to 60, and I'll be reading from the New Living Translation. Your decrees have been the theme of my songs wherever I have lived. I reflect at night on who you are, O Lord. Therefore, I obey your instructions. This is how I spend my life, obeying your commandments. Lord, you are mine. I promise to obey your words. With all my heart, I want your blessings. Be merciful as you promised. I pondered the direction of my life and I turned to follow your laws. I will hurry without delay to obey your commands. Amen.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. I gotta tell you, I love how the scripture works out to talk to the people who are reading it too. You remind me of that passage, brother. You remind me of that passage. I'm not sure if Daryl does that, or if that's just God doing it, or a combination of the two. I think it's a combination of the two, but God always seems to make it work out that the person who's reading, it's a word for them or a word that reflects their life. So I'm going to give my plug in here that if you'd like to be a volunteer to be one of our readers, we're always welcoming more. We always love to have more people in the rotation.
Don't be scared.
Yeah, don't be scared. We all love each other. You hear me mess up every single week. Yeah, don't worry.
Don't worry.
Miss Anna will cheer you on. Miss Anna will cheer you on. Amen. Now is the time in our service where we give back God's tithe and our offerings. It's a time where we say thank you to God for what he has given to us and done for us, and also a time where we ask for God's help that we might be good stewards of all that he's trusted us with. So please join me in prayer. Father God, again, as we're celebrating Veterans Day here at church today, we thank you for the lives that you give us. And Father, I pray that you would help us to live those lives in a way that help our brothers and sisters. That you would help us to live our lives in such a way that we are willing to sacrifice in order to care for and protect and provide for those who are in need and those who are lost. Father, I know it happens in different ways in our lives based on our giftings and strengths and the place and time we live. But I pray, Father, that you would have us all live our lives in such a way that we might lay down at the end of our journey and have no regrets about the choices we made. Father, as I bring that up, I pray that you would help us, that you would help us to be wise and kind and loving in the choices that we make. I pray that as individuals, you would help each of us to be good managers of what you've trusted us with, our time, our skills and talents, and our resources, Father. Especially that time one right now. There's so much in our society pulling at our time, trying to distract us from you, trying to tie us up and take us off the field. I pray, Father, that you would help us to be focused on you, focused on how you call us to live, focused on your word. And I pray that you would help us as a body to hold each other accountable and spur each other on to good works. I also pray that you would help us as a church, that you would help the food pantry, that you would help the Sunday breakfast mission, that you would help us all to be good stewards of the resources and responsibilities you've entrusted us with. Father, as we're preparing to end another year, I also ask for special blessing of wisdom for our church board as we are getting ready to prepare a new budget for next year. I pray, Father, that you would help us to be wise and trusting in how we live. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
During offering, we'll be singing the song Same God, and as always, please feel free to stand with us during offering once you're able to do so.
I'm calling on the God. You answered prayers back then, and you will answer now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were providing then. You are providing now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You moved in power then. God, move in power now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were a healer then. You are a healer now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were a savior then. You are a savior now. You are the same God. You are the same God. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh Rock, oh Rock of Ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. On your faithfulness.
Our next song, we invite you to enter into a posture of prayer, to prepare our hearts for prayer, to not just speak to God, but also to listen to God. The song that we'll be playing in the background is one that you've heard before. You're welcome to sing along. It's called Lead Me to the Cross. Foot of the cross is where we find life, where we find healing. Even though the cross was originally meant to be a symbol of death and destruction and depression, through the resurrection of Christ, the cross means life to us. If you're looking for a scripture to meditate on during this song, I think Psalm 119 is a wonderful one out of what Jim read today. Jim read from verses 54 to 60, but verse 55 says, I reflect at night on who you are, O Lord, and therefore I obey your instructions. It is good to spend time in reflection, to spend time thinking about God and listening to the Holy Spirit, to spend time reflecting on His Word. And that time is vital to our relationship with God. If we don't put that time in, we'll be strangers to God. And we don't want that to happen. So please join us as we enter into a posture of prayer. You're welcome to stay in your seat or join me here at the altar.
Redemption.
shepherd to the hill where we find life. Father, we thank you for the gift of your Son. We thank you for the gift of grace and love and forgiveness that's offered through him. Father, we thank you for your Holy Spirit poured out for all of us, Father, on all of us. Father, thank you. As we prayed earlier, Father, we want to lift up our veterans today. We want to lift up those who are still carrying wounds from their times in the service. And we want to lift up those who have lost friends, those who have lost family members, siblings, spouses, children, parents. Father, we come to you as people who live in a world that's not as it should be. A world where there is sin and evil and death and war. And we long, Father, as we pray the prayer your Son taught us, that your kingdom would come and your will would be done on earth as it is in heaven. Until that day, Father, until that day of glorification, I pray that you would help each and every one of us to be your obedient children, to offer ourselves consistently every day as living sacrifices to you. Father, we lift up our brothers and sisters in the church today, many of whom have great need. We lift up Charlie's brother Malcolm to you, Father. We pray that you would be present with him in his illness, and that you would be with Charlie and his siblings as they seek to love and minister to Malcolm. We pray, Father, for our brother Eric and the health struggles he's dealing with. We pray, Father, that you would help him with these symptoms that he's struggling with, and that you would help him to rest and regain energy. We lift up our sister Faye, Father. We thank you that she had some extra visitors this week to help encourage her. And we pray, Father, that through family and friends and visitors and staff, that she would have people around to help shed some light in her day. Father, we thank you that we can celebrate Wilma's birthday today, and we lift up Tony and Wilma to you in their need. We lift up Charles and Donna, Father. You know their needs. Pray for Nancy and her brothers as they care. Father, we pray for the situation in Israel and Gaza. Father, it breaks our heart to see the atrocities that happened when Hamas invaded Israel and to see so many innocent who are dying now in this conflict. Father, we pray for peace, that fighting would stop. We especially pray, Father, that innocent civilians, especially the children, would be able to get out of harm's way. We lift up those in Ukraine who are facing another winter of war, Father. We lift up those in Syria as there are now multiple bombings happening. Father, we lift up our brothers and sisters in Iceland who are facing a volcanic eruption right now. We pray, Father, for safety. We thank you that they've been able to evacuate the city where they believe it's going to strike, and we pray that everyone would be able to get out of harm's way. Father, we lift up our different ministries this holiday season through Thanksgiving and Christmas. We know this is a time when loss and need are felt much more deeply than the rest of the year. And I pray that you would help each of us to be a part of meeting those needs, of caring for those people, for caring for one another. We lift up our food pantry, Father. We lift up the Sunday breakfast mission. We lift up so many around our world who are seeking to help right now. And I pray that as we meet material needs through food baskets at Thanksgiving and gifts and clothing at Christmas and warm clothes for our homeless brothers and sisters, it would also help us to share hope, an eternal solution to our need. Today, Father, I ask that you'd help us during this service, that you would help us as we finish out Paul's letter to the Ephesians, that you would help us to embody his prayer of grace and peace. Father, help us to know what that is and to live it in our lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
So as I just mentioned, and you might have guessed based on our schedule, today is the finale of our time in Ephesians. I know it seems like just yesterday we began. It was actually a year ago. But today is our last day in Ephesians. I want to take a moment here. Today's going to be a little extra. We're talking about the content of the letter, but we're also going to be talking a little bit about the author of the letter, Paul. Paul is called different things. The fancy title he has is apostle. I think in the modern church, we'd also call him a missionary. And one of the things that I've been thinking about, five of us got to go to a missionary training day yesterday that was hosted by the district, and we got to hear from a missionary couple, Wilfredo and Anna Swala Marciaga. And one of the conversations we had after that, I was talking to Rich as we were finishing up, that missionaries are people too. Might sound funny, right? But I know when I was a kid, I was lucky enough to go to a church when I was a child, and I always thought of missionaries as kind of like superheroes. You guys ever think that? Like, you hear some of the things missionaries do or places they go, and you think, man, I could never do that. You know, they must be without fear. You know, like when Rebecca was sharing about where she's been and where she's going, I thought, man, I would be terrified to do what God is calling her to do. But you hear their stories and you find out that missionaries are regular people. Missionaries are regular people who God has called to step into sometimes extraordinary circumstances. One of the things that Marciaga shared yesterday was part of their journey through the pandemic season. We were doing a question and answer with them, and somebody asked them if they had any children. And they shared that no, they don't have any children, but they did lose a pregnancy in 2021 during the pandemic. They are living in Panama now, and that's where they were at the time. And at the time when Anna lost her pregnancy, they were locked down. Panama was locked down pretty tight, and people couldn't travel. And she's from Guatemala, that's where her family's from, and so her family and friends could not travel to be with her during that time of loss and mourning. And really nobody could. It was she and her husband stuck in the house for almost 8 months. But she said during that season, one of the churches that was connected to them at the time, a church in Barbados, one lady in that church kind of took it on herself to call every single day and check on them and pray with them. And she talked about how special it was to know that even though they were in a different place, far from family, that they were part of a body, and that there was somebody who loved them, who was praying for them, who was listening to them. And we get to see a little bit of that in today's letter. I'm spoiling the ending a little bit, but in the end of this passage, Paul talks about some of the people he's with and the journeys that are happening. It's a little personal business note kind of lifted up. But we see that in several of Paul's letters, where he sends greetings to certain friends or mentions who's traveling where. Keep your eye out for my friend so-and-so, they're headed your way. In one letter he says, can you send a friend of mine to bring my coat and my papers? Because I left my coat behind. Yeah. And so we get to see these personal glimpses into Paul's writing. And we think of the book of Ephesians as a book of the Bible, and it is, but the book of Ephesians was also a letter. And it was written by a person, Paul, to people, the church in Ephesus. And they weren't strangers. They were people who knew each other. And these co-workers with Paul, people like, we're going to mention Tychicus today, but people like Barnabas or Silas or even John Mark, even though they had some bumps, they were friends. And they got to serve in the body together, and serving together offered them an important encouragement. That was kind of what we talked about in Sunday school today, that we are the temple of God and that every block in the temple is important. We're all important. We need one another. So I'm already off my outline, so give me a second here. we're going to read the scripture for today. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 18 through 24. I'll be reading from the New Living Translation. The words are up on the screen, and you're welcome to follow along in your Bible. Pray in the Spirit at all times and on every occasion. Stay alert and be persistent in your prayers for all believers everywhere. And pray for me too. Ask God to give me the right words so I can boldly explain God's mysterious plan that the good news is for Jews and Gentiles alike. I am in chains now, still preaching this message as God's ambassador. So pray that I will keep on speaking boldly for him as I should. To bring you up to date, Tychicus will give you a full report about what I'm doing and how I'm getting along. He is a beloved brother and a faithful helper in the Lord's work. I have sent him to you for this very purpose, to let you know how we are doing and to encourage you. Peace be with you, dear brothers and sisters, and may God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ give you love with faithfulness. May God's grace be eternally upon all who love our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. First, we transition, might seem abruptly, from our discussion of armor the last couple of weeks, as Sir Albert so helpfully modeled for us. We transition from a discussion of armor into prayer. Now, you might have noticed, if you maybe stuck last week's bulletin in your Bible, that we doubled up on a verse. We've been moving through Ephesians, and this is the first time that we read the same verse in two different weeks. Last week, we ended with verse 18, and today we pick it up. Paul had been talking about the armor of God, and he closed out that discussion by saying, pray in the Spirit at all times and on every occasion. Stay alert and be persistent in your prayers for believers everywhere, for all believers everywhere. Now, that tied in very nicely with the armor, but I think it's a beautiful segue into where Paul is going next. See, when Paul says, pray for all believers, do you know who he's including in that list?
Us,
yeah. And the church in Ephesus, yeah. But also himself. Paul is talking about his need for prayer. Not just his need to be in prayer, like he's advising them, but also his need for them to pray for him. It's a personal request, and it's a reminder that we're in this together. People like Paul, we can think of him as a larger-than-life figure, and he certainly had some pretty amazing things happen to him and through him in his life. But he's a person, and he's trying to get through life just like the rest of us. We'll talk in a minute about the fact that he was in chains as he wrote this. Paul was imprisoned multiple times, and several of his letters were written while he was in prison. And even when he wasn't in prison, he was usually chased from town to town. If you read through the missionary journey of Paul in Acts or read through his letters, you see that he follows a pattern. He comes to a town, he visits a synagogue, they chase him out, then he preaches in the town square, and then they either arrest him, stone him, or run him out of town. And that just happens over and over again. Then you throw in the middle, there's some shipwrecks and a snake bite and some betrayal by people. It was a bumpy journey. It was a bumpy journey. I think Paul knows through his writings to the church in Ephesus that they were having some bumps in their journey. And I think he's trying to model for us that as members of the body of Christ, prayer is vital to our life. Us praying to God, us listening to God, but also us praying for one another. That happens in one way when we're in church, when we pray corporately. When I lead the congregational prayer, it's my role in that moment to pray for us as a congregation, to speak on behalf of the congregation. But it's also our role as individuals to pray for one another. Does anybody here listen to the prayer requests we share? Yeah, a few of us. Anybody write them down? I know a couple of you have adopted my habit of keeping a notebook. I know for me, I can't remember all the prayer requests without writing them down. Paul here is sharing a specific request for himself. He transitions, we're going into verses 19 and 20 now. As he says, pray for me, he says, ask God to give me the right words so I can boldly explain God's mysterious plan that the good news is for Jews and Gentiles alike. I am in chains now, still preaching this message as God's ambassador. So pray that I will keep on speaking boldly for him as I should. He's beseeching them to intercede. We call this intercessory prayer, when you pray for somebody else, like how we prayed for Charlie's brother a little bit ago, or we prayed for Eric, Barbara's brother. We intercede, we pray to God on behalf of someone else. God, my brother or sister needs help. They need guidance, they need salvation, they need healing, right? Intercessory prayer is usually about a need. They need wisdom. Here, Paul is asking for the right words. Sounds kind of funny, right? Paul wrote individually probably more words than anybody else in the New Testament. I know he's right up. Luke wrote a lot too, because he gets Luke and Acts, but man, he's up there, right? One of the top two for a number of words written in the Bible. For somebody like that, who seems so good at speaking and arguing and teaching and writing, for him to ask God for the right words, it almost sounds funny, right? It's like Superman asking for flight, right? He seems to already have it. Why do you think Paul would pray this prayer? Did he have the skill to speak? Yeah. Was it his own skill that he was supposed to rely on? No. That's one of the dangers, and I think it's a danger Paul faced. As someone who was well-educated, someone who was trained as a Pharisee, a Roman citizen, who spoke languages and traveled, it could be very tempting to lean on his own wisdom in order to write these words. But he's asking for prayer that God would give him the right words. That God would give him the right words so that he can do what? Explain God's mysterious plan. Well, that's nice. I certainly need God's mysteries explained to me. But he's not just speaking vaguely of explaining the mysteries of God. He's speaking specifically about his calling. We hear about this in the book of Acts when Paul is called, but he has a very specific calling, and that's to bring the good news to the Gentiles. That means people who were not raised Jewish, people who were not ethnically Jewish, people who up until this point were thought of as not able to be welcomed into the family of God because they weren't born into the family of God. It was Paul's calling to explain this mystery that the good news is for everybody. You know, Jews, that's Jewish people. Gentiles are not Jewish people. So if we've got Jews and Gentiles, guess who we have? Everybody. God's good news is for everyone. I am in chains now. It's just a few words in the middle of a large letter. But it makes me think about Paul as a person. The things that he's written about the armor of God, about being a part of God's body, about being in relationship. It's pretty isolating living in chains, isn't it? Yeah. That was Paul's life in this moment. He's cut off from physical contact with his brothers and sisters because he's been imprisoned. But is he really alone? You see, Paul has learned to live in prayer, but also to rely on these letters. I know we can think of these letters as something that Paul needed to do for the church in Ephesus, or Paul needed to do for us. But I also think it was God's gift to Paul to allow him to have these letters going back and forth. We don't have all the copies of these letters, but in Paul's writings, he alludes to the fact that they're sending stuff back and forth. Paul gets to have this exchange, this contact, even though he's in chains. And even in these chains, if I were in chains and I was praying, or if you were in chains and you had a chance to pray to God, do you think you might pray for God to take you out of the chains? I I think I probably would have thrown that in there. Sure, I'd ask for God to give me the words. Good prayer request, Paul. But I probably would have slipped that little one in there, right? Oh, and also, please get me out of jail. Did Paul pray for that?
No.
No. See, there's this really cool thing that you see in Paul's life, and particularly here in this passage. Paul was called to be this minister of the gospel, to be this apostle, to share this good news. And being in prison didn't stop that. It didn't harm it. In fact, it almost seems to have fanned the flames of Paul's sharing for him to be in chains. Doesn't have any other distractions to deal with, right? Yeah, he's not mowing the lawn when he's in chains. He's got all day to write. The outside situation seems terrible. To say you're a missionary, what do missionaries do? They go around, right? They travel. Look at Paul's missionary journeys. He circled around the Mediterranean, right? All these places. And yet here he is in chains. It's like, how do you do that? It's like, I'm going to drive my car, but it's got no tires. And yet in the midst of that situation, that would seem like it would stop things dead in their tracks, stop Paul's ability to serve, stop God's ability to use Paul, we see that the Spirit makes a way, that these letters are shared back and forth. And because this was shared in letters rather than just spoken out loud, we have copies of it so that you and I get to enjoy it. So pray, I will keep on speaking boldly for him as I should. Speaking boldly while in chains is a difficult thing, isn't it? It is. It is. We got to take a little family trip this week. We did a college visit with Annika. And while we were on that campus, there was a protest. As there often are on college campuses, you know, young people have lots of energy. And there was this interesting thing that there were kind of concentric circles around the protest. There was a young man who was kind of in the middle of the circle and he was standing up on like a little concrete wall kind of thing, and he had a bullhorn. And man, he was shouting and cheering and he was talking. And then there were the people who were right up close, right? And they were shouting and cheering too. And then you have another ring of people who were clearly facing the guy and listening and part of the protest, but they were a lot quieter. And then on the outside, there was a ring of police. And I know that the police were there to keep things calm and safe. But I imagine if I was a guy in the middle of that protest yelling and I was looking out at the police officers around, I'd feel a little bit nervous, wouldn't you? Yeah. Part of the reason I think that young man felt comfortable speaking boldly wasn't just his personal conviction, it was also that he was surrounded by people who were supporting him, right? Multiple rings of people. So there were the people who maybe, you know, it seemed like some of the campus administrators who were there maybe kind of wanted him to stop. the people who didn't want him to keep going, or the people who skittered by real fast because they were uncomfortable hearing what was being said. But he had that boldness because he was surrounded. I think that's what we see here with Paul. Even though physically he's in chains and physically he's alone, he knows that he's not. He knows that he has God with him through the presence of the Holy Spirit. And he also knows he has these rings of people, at this point, all around their known world, right? From the Middle East, down into parts of Africa, and up around into the Mediterranean, and into Europe, and, you know, multiple continents. Pray that I will keep on speaking boldly. Then he adds this kind of personal thing, this checking in with friends moment. I'm picking up at verse 21 here. To bring you up to date, it's like the Facebook post, right? To bring you up to date, Tychicus will give you a full report about what I'm doing and how I'm getting along. He is a beloved brother and faithful helper in the Lord's work. I've sent him to you for this very purpose, to let you know how we are doing and to encourage you. Paul does this in other places. As I mentioned, he had many co-workers in his ministry. This person, Tychicus, He's described as a beloved brother. I imagine that that brought a lot of warmth and hope to Paul, knowing that he had beloved brothers. Mm. It wasn't long before this that Paul was a persecutor of the church. And these people forgave him, and they recognized his repentance, and they welcomed him in as a brother. Now, this friend Tychicus has to give a full report. We can wonder why. Maybe Paul couldn't fit everything in the letter. I think maybe more so there were some sensitive things that it might not be good to write down while you were in chains. A little bit like when we've had missionary speaker before, sometimes we gotta turn the camera off and share some of those details in private. But the biggest thing here is we've got a faithful brother traveling from one to another to share not just information, but to share encouragement. I think the church in Ephesus needed some encouragement. They were in a hard way, and a lot of this letter was pointing out things that they were doing that they should not be doing. The examples that Paul uses in this letter of how people are supposed to live and how churches are supposed to function and how we're supposed to be a unified body, they would have been pretty convicting to a lot of people in the church. And so Tychicus is sent to share information and to encourage. Because we can't do this alone, right? It's not just about learning. It's not memorizing facts for a quiz. It's about relationships and change and growth. And that takes people. And it takes time. And it's slow. And it's messy. But it's also beautiful. Paul had beloved brothers and sisters in ministry because he had traveled around for years living with people, working side by side with people, feeding the hungry, sometimes making tents to pay the bills, sometimes being cold without a coat, sometimes being hungry without dinner, sometimes sleeping rough because they didn't have a place to stay. And this service together built a camaraderie, is not even the right word. It built them into a family. Have you ever experienced that in church? When you get to serve alongside people, we become family. I got to experience what it was to be the new guy in this church for a while, right? It wasn't that long ago that I first came here, and nobody knew who I was. And y'all welcomed me in. And we get to do life together and be a family together. Amen. That's how Jesus wants it to be. That's what the intention was, and it's what the apostles taught. It's what Paul taught. And without rambling further too much, we come to Paul's closing, and this is a closing that Paul uses often. It varies a little bit, but he often speaks this benediction, you might say, the good words of grace and peace. Now, I think in our churches, in our music, in our scripture, we're used to hearing those words together. But remember, letter writing used to be a little bit more of an art than it is now, and particularly in Paul's day, there were certain cultural patterns of how you addressed a letter, how you closed a letter, right? Maybe you had to learn this in first or second or third grade like I did. Now the kids just learn emojis, I think. But closing a letter with peace, opening and closing a letter with peace, that was a Jewish tradition. The word shalom, right? Peace be with you. It was a way they would greet each other when they met. And it's a word they would share with each other when they parted. And so it was also a word that was used to open and close writing back and forth, correspondence. In the Gentile traditions, they would often use the word grace, grace. And so even in Paul's letter, he's uniting the Jew and the Gentile, grace and peace. Peace be with you, dear brothers and sisters. They've gotten a lot of stern talking to from Paul. This happens in other letters too, like the church in Corinth. But recognize how Paul feels, his real connection with them. He's not treating them as a problem to be solved, right? Or people to be dealt with. He's treating them as his dear brothers and sisters, his siblings who he loves. And he's praying that God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ would give them this love, this faithfulness, this peace, this grace. May the grace be eternally upon all who love our Lord Jesus Christ. I know sometimes when we close letters, we don't really mean what we say. I know one of the traditional closings for letters in the United States has been sincerely. Are you always sincere when you write that? Here's my electric bill. Sincerely, Paul. I ain't that sincere about my electric bill, right? I think Paul's quite sincere about this closing here. He wants these people to know what it is to experience change. Paul was a man who, when we meet him, did not have grace and peace in his life. He didn't have this loving community. His life was all about fear and rules and domination and even violence and murder. And yet he comes to know Christ and everything is turned upside down. In some ways, if you looked at the trajectory of Paul's life, it seems to go downhill. The boxes that the world would check, like the respect of your peers and financial success and, you know, being an upstanding member of the community and all those things. Paul gave all that up when he gave up his life as a Pharisee. He became a homeless traveler who ended up with oppression from those inside the Jewish faith and also from eventually the Roman authorities. Everybody wants to beat him and lock him up and shut him up. And yet, if you look at what happened to him on the inside, this is what he got. Peace. Love and faithfulness, grace, joy. These are the things that Paul writes about when he's in prison. And you probably heard me talk about Philippians chapter 4. That's another prison passage that really touches my heart. And so, as I close today, we're here, right? We're not in chains, although some of us face chains. Some of us are facing physical struggles that are binding our life and robbing us of our joy. Some of us are carrying wounds from the past. Some of those wounds are self-inflicted. What Paul is sharing here with the people is that when we walk together in love, in obedience to Christ, full of the Spirit, those things no longer define our reality. The chains, the thorn in his flesh that he writes about in another place, they no longer define what is real and what is true. What is real and true is that we're loved by God, and that eclipses everything else. It doesn't mean it's gone, and Paul still has to deal with the everyday realities. I'm locked up in a cold jail. Can you please bring me a coat? Right? I'm not trying to sugarcoat it. I'm just saying Paul got something so much deeper. He traded something superficial for something that was genuine. And that's what he wants the church in Ephesus to do. To stop arguing over the superficial, stop seeking the superficial, and to seek what is deep and true and real. Because there's so much more than the physical. We talked about that in the armor of God section, right? You're not fighting against earthly powers, you're fighting a spiritual war. And you need things like righteousness and truth and the Spirit to carry you through. It's hard to sum up the book of Ephesians in a sentence or two, so I'm not really going to try, but I think this closing is what Paul wants. Paul wants to see the church in Ephesus to be a body, a healthy body, a body where the people love one another, care for one another, a body where people are passionate about serving Christ, dedicating their whole lives as an offering to the Lord, and not just for themselves, but to be poured out for others. As Paul said, his life has been poured out as an offering to the Lord, like a drink offering poured on the ground. That's what he wants us to understand, that when we empty ourselves, when we pour ourselves out for the Lord, it's only then that we get filled. I hope you know what that is, and if you don't, man, choose it quick. Don't waste another day. I'll pray next week, or maybe the candlelight service, or I've got to do this first, or talk to that person first. Don't wait. Don't wait.
Tomorrow never is.
Father God, thank you for these words. Thank you for the book of Ephesians, this letter from Paul. Thank you for our brothers and sisters in Ephesus. And I pray, Father, that this experience of reading this letter together, corporately, would be sacramental for us, Father. It would be a time where we experience grace, where we experience you, your spirit, your love. I pray, Father, that if we are making these mistakes or bad choices that the church in Ephesus was making, of having division and hatred, of judging based on the superficial, seeking the superficial, rather than that which is real, I pray, Father, that you would help us turn, that you would give us the wisdom to understand the error of our ways, and that you would give us the heart through your spirit to choose your way. I pray, Father, that we would be sanctified, that we would be made holy, fully set apart for you as your special possession, and that our lives would completely be an offering to you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
We are going to finish the service with the song of the blessing. Please stand if you're able, and please join us. We'll skip over to one.
together as our benediction. You might know this comes from Numbers chapter 6. It's the priestly blessing. I ask you if you're able to read along with me. The Lord bless you and keep you and make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Go in God's grace and be God's people. Don't forget, we're back here tonight at 6 for the adult Bible study in room 6. We are not having our kids program tonight, but it should be back soon. Yay.